We'll be speaking now with former Finance Secretary Roberto de Ocampo. Mr. Ocampo, good morning to you. Thanks for joining us today. And again, our deepest condolences.
Good morning, Carmina. Thank you for inviting. I'm actually here at the state funeral site, so I'm sorry I couldn't join you in person.
No worries, but we thank you still for sharing your time with us as we talk about your good friend. He was not just your boss, he was also your good friend. In fact, you were one of those that he really listened to. Tell us about, why he was successful in steering the economy. He was known as a military man. He was never seen as an economist. How was he able to bring in renewed growth into an economy that was widely seen as the sick man of Asia?
I think, Carmina, it's because he had a very strong belief that economic democracy must accompany political democracy. We had just gone through a peaceful revolution that reinstalled democracy politically, but our economy was still in bad shape. And of course, up to now, people think that our democracy is more unwieldy than other countries around us that seem to have less political democracy, but quite a bit of economic democracy. Now, he was a very accomplished administrator and manager. And of course, he was very dedicated to the principle that the private sector must be the main engine of growth. So economic democracy meant being able to unshackle the private sector at all levels by giving them the tools, the opportunities, the economic environment so that they could move themselves forward and thereby move the entire economy forward. He showed this by having the private sector as part of the transformation of infrastructure under the BOT, or Build, Operate, and Transfer scheme that he introduced. And he was also the author or initiator of the APEC Business Advisory Council that put the private sector squarely within the globalization strategy of the entire world. I would say that those are the things that made him succeed, his focus on being able to advance economic democracy.
Mr. De Ocampo, tell us about Steady Eddie and Tiger Bobby and why the two of you really had that teamwork going for you. What was it that made your relationship with the former president that special?
First, we tend to both be technocrats more than politicians. So I wasn't having an inordinate amount of time trying to concoct photo ops for him. And instead, we would talk about Philippines 2000. In other words, having a specific game plan for bringing the country at a specific economic level. And that's one of the reasons. Mm-hmm. The other, I guess, is on the lighter side, we both loved golf. And he was always asking me to be his golf partner, since he felt I was fairly good at the sport. And so part of the camaraderie sprang from our common love of the sport. Mm. But I think that more importantly, we approach things much more on a technocratic side and has a similar idea of formulating a vision for everyone, whether it's in the legislative branch or executive branch, to focus upon.
Secretary, was there a healthy competition between the two of you? I mean, he was active, you were active, he had his sports, you had your sports. Was there something of that sort between the two of you, aside, of course, from, you know, being the technocrats that you are?
I think it was less competition than it was mutual respect. Mm-hmm. We had the same idea of combining mental alertness with physical fitness. And the idea that whatever it is that you do, you try to excel it to the highest level that you could, whether it is a sport or whether it's a job at hand. And therefore, as some people might put it, we were Magka vibes, because we were on the same wavelength with respect to certain principles of life and good governance.
But things weren't all that rosy. Tell us about how that relationship and how that teamwork was challenged when the Asian financial crisis hit.
Yes, definitely that was the biggest challenge towards the end. Fortunately, because of what we had done before the Asian financial crisis, the Philippines was actually one of the strongest economies and the least affected by the Asian crisis. But both of us, and I have to include in the team facing that Asian crisis, the late Gabby Singson, who was also very close to FBR, all of us were not the types to press the panic button and start panicking the rest of the public. Instead, we looked at it as calmly as we could and decide from what were the parameters to be addressed, what action steps to take in a steady eddy manner. Mm-hmm. You don't just suddenly press the panic button and put in draconian measures when they are not necessary. Instead, you put measures and you put in policies in a measured manner so that you don't imbue the public with a state of panic. And then you provide yourself time to measure what is the entire scope of the problem at hand before you do anything else beyond the measures you thought of.
Talk to us more about that little room in Malacañang where he would send members of the cabinet to iron out their differences through bull sessions. Were you ever an occupant of that room?
Yes, I was.
Who with? Would you care to share?
With a friend of mine who at that time happened to be the Secretary of Trade. Because you see, Department of Finance is attuned towards raising revenues, right? And Department of Trade is attuned to attracting investors, and sometimes they do that by incentives. Incentives have a tendency to erode the revenue stream. So you've got this balancing act between raising revenues or maintaining exemptions for investors, and this has gone on for years. At that time, I was proposing a means by which we could, in a sense, lessen the incentives, particularly for those industries that have had exemptions for too long. So-called infant industries, which had long been no longer infant. So we had this discussion, and we weren't able to come to terms. So the president called us and put us in this room, and after giving us a little bit of his own pep talk, said, "Okay, we'll sort it out, and I'll come back later."
But would he join you? Was there a point when?
No. He would join and then he would leave. Mm. It was like it was like electing the Pope by the College of Cardinals. You don't get fed until you figure out who's going to be the Pope. Mm. And so we would discuss, knowing that the president's coming back, expecting that we would have sorted this thing out in one way or the other.
And what does that tell you?
It had to work.
What does that tell you about his leadership style?
It tells me that he knows how to manage democracy. Some people are impatient with the Philippines because of our alleged unwieldy democracy, but President Ramos accepted democracy and all its unwieldiness, and instead would use the tools of vision, definition of objectives, and commonality of a desire to see the Philippines at a much higher place than it is today, rather than trying to strong-arm anybody or setting aside democratic processes by dictating what he wants. Mm. And he did this not only in the case of the small room exercise that I just described to you, but he would convene what was then known as the LEDAC, or the Legislative Economic Development Advisory Council, composed of senators and congressmen, so that the subject matter would already be outlined in a specific agenda that was anything but political maneuvering. Mm. So everybody had to focus on Philippines 2000 and ask themselves constantly the question, what is my contribution to making Philippines 2000 happen?
And do
certainly
you find
that contribution? Yes.
Yeah. And yes, do you find that? I'm sorry to cut you there, Secretary. But do you find that ironic, coming from a military man used to, you know, giving out orders and giving out commands, and yet here he is as president, building consensus?
Yes, and it is somewhat ironic. But you see, it is combined with a military discipline of being organized and working purposefully. You know, one can work as hard as you can, but you may look like a gerbil on a treadmill, running furiously but going nowhere. On the other hand, one can work hard but purposefully, organize, defining objectives, and getting the consensus of those that are following you, even though you are obviously the one to lead the charge. So, yes, there's a bit of irony to it, but I have worked with a number of people who had a military background, and especially a military background within a democratic setting, and they are able to realize what it takes to get work done in a democratic consensus type of environment, but they are also organized enough so that those they work with arrive at a common, you might say, feeling that even they should not be acting haphazardly.
Secretary, I wish we had more time to talk to you today, but as I understand, the remains are about to leave the Heritage Park, and we do want to give you some time to say farewell to your good friend as well. We appreciate you joining us this morning. Thank you. And again, our deepest condolences. Former
Thank
Finance Secretary Roberto de Ocampo, they are joining us today, talking to us about his friendship with former President Fidel V. Ramos, as well as his working relationship with the late president.